The Lord God is my strength, and He will make my feet as hinds feet, and He will make me to walk the high places. The Lord God is my strength, and He will make my feet as hinds feet, and He will make me to walk upon the high places. Yea, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. Yea, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. He will make me to walk. The Lord God is my strength, and He will make my feet as hinds feet, and He will make me to walk upon the high places. The Lord God is my strength, and He will make my feet as hinds feet, and He will make me to walk upon the high places. Yeah, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. Yeah, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. He will make me to walk.
Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you again for your tender love for us. And Lord, we're grateful for thy holy Sabbath. And Lord, even as you have provided a new pulpit, a new podium for your word to be expressed, and not only that, but the understanding to be given to it, that it might be understood, that lives might be changed, I am grateful for the opportunity of standing here. But of myself, Lord, I am unworthy. And all of my worthiness and all of my goodness is only in Thee. And so, Lord, you know what your people need. You know what has been prepared. And I give you permission, Lord, to change it in whatever way you desire. For whatever the hearts that are both watching online and for those that are sitting here in the congregation. So be with us now, I pray, and give us of your Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen. So the group that's going to be going to Africa, how many people are here that are going to be going to Africa? Could you raise your hands for me? Okay, I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. And so there's quite a number of people that are going to be going. For those of you who are not going to Africa, that's okay. Medical missionary work and medical missionary training is for those of us who not only are going to be going to foreign lands, but for those of us that are especially going to be here. And this morning we're going to deal with something that I call the Great Distress. And so we're going to be talking about stress and its effects upon the body. Okay? But before I do, I want to explain to you why you see some of these things here. So here, you see, I brought a suitcase, and in this suitcase is my medical missionary kit. And so there are many different things that we're going to be covering while we're in our classes that we're going to be having, like this one here. This one here is called colon pure. It's just psyllium husk. We're going to be talking about cleansing the colon and how it affects. We're going to be dealing with this one here. This is activated charcoal. I'm going to show you how to make charcoal. So that even if you don't, if those of you who might go to Africa and those who may not, so you'll know how to make your own charcoal and then also how to use it for healing. And so if you don't have charcoal, also I have here a bag of sugar. And, you know, I don't suggest that you have lots of sugar or that you eat lots of sugar, but I do believe that sugar should be in all of our households. I'm going to show you what sugar is and what it does, and we're going to be covering that as well. So all kinds of different things. I have some extra virgin olive oil in here. You'll see we have potatoes, we have pumpkin seeds, we have carrots, we have cabbage, we have onions. We also have some vitamin C here, and this one's going to be very important. I really want to encourage those that are going to Africa to maybe take their own vitamin C. Vitamin C is cheap. We vitamin C, for what it does, is extremely cheap. We got some other fruits here. This is a grapefruit, which they may not have in Africa, but I'll show you some things about it. I believe also we have some cayenne pepper, and this is the 90,000, which I'll keep it in the bag because I don't want it to get in my eyes. I made that mistake one time. I was my favorite salad dressing is a very, very simple dressing. And my favorite salad dressing is one part honey, one part olive oil, and one part lemon juice. And you just mix it up, and when you put it in a glass jar, it separates and it's real pretty. And then you can mix it up and you pour it on, and I like my salad to be sweet. I don't know about you. And so, but I put some cayenne pepper in this salad dressing I did one day, and I was having class with our students, last year it was, and something, a tomato fell off my fork or something and hit it, and it splashed right in my eye. Oh man, it burned for about a few moments, and then I was like, oh man, I think I see better. It was real nice. I was actually, it only hurt for like a couple of minutes. We have here some Epsom salt, and we'll talk more about that. You know, I brought a little bag here that I have as well to show you how to make your own little medical missionary kit, something that you can have for yourself. And so I just wanted to show you these things. The thing that I try to teach when I teach health classes, I try to teach the people not to be focused on what you don't have, but to use what you do have and to know why it works so that you can switch it if you need to. You know, we'll tell you the difference. If you don't have sugar, I'm going to show you how you can use bananas instead, depending upon what the application is, okay? All right. So we prayed, and now I want to go to the screen, and I have a question for you. It's probably the most important question anybody has ever asked. Do you love Jesus? You know, there's a lot of reasons why we can do the things that we do. But if this is not the number one reason, it really doesn't matter. See, medical ministry is about love. Please turn with me in your Bibles, if you would, to the book of Matthew, chapter 25. Matthew, chapter 25. See, there are those in the Bible that want to get medical missionary training, but they don't like people. They're trained how to do things, but they're very specific on who they're going to do them for. I don't know if you've ever noticed this. I was going to a church, and at this church, the head elders, one of the elders' wives, and this is not this church, and this is a reflection on nobody here. I don't know anything like this here, but she would never, ever wash anybody's feet or let her feet be washed. She had a feet thing. You know, she didn't like feet. She didn't want you touching hers, and she don't want to touch yours. She would do she'd drink the juice and she'd eat the bread, but she wouldn't wash the feet. And I'm like, sister, do you understand that service was there for humility? It was to break our hearts. Because everybody's feet is nasty. Well, there's a couple of you who have pretty, pretty feet, but anybody have feet like me? Lord, have mercy. Matthew chapter 25 and verse 31, the Bible says, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and how many angels? And all the holy angels with him. Then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered how many nations? All nations. And he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come, ye blessed of my Father. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you from when, everyone? So wait a second. This kingdom was made for you before you were even from the foundation of the world. And it says, for I was hungered and you gave me meat. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. Naked and you clothed me. The Bible says, he says, I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came unto me. Then shall the what? The righteous, those who do the right things. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee an hungered and fed thee, or thirsty and gave thee drink? Or when saw we thee a stranger and took thee in, or naked and clothed thee? Or when saw we thee sick or in prison and came unto thee? And the king, and the what? The king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto what? one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me. And so what did they do? What was so valuable? Well, you know what they were doing? They were supplying the needs of those that they met. That's medical ministry. Medical missionary work, gospel medical missionary work, is less about herbs and more about love. See, love supplies the needs of others. If you see somebody is homeless and you see they have a need, the Bible says our job is to bring them to our house. You understand? And then in the judgment, many people are going to look up and say, well, you know, the Lord rejects them. And he says, wait a second, I did all this work. I preached all these things. I traveled. I did all these things. And the Lord's like, wait a second, you didn't do the thing that I needed. I needed a place to stay. And you said, no, but when were you homeless? He says, well, when you didn't do it for them, you didn't do it for me. And so this is the point that I really want to stress, is that medical ministry is about love. And you and I don't naturally love other people. It's something that we get from Jesus. And so when you ask the question, do you love Jesus? That's the only way you're going to love anybody else. At least that's what I've come to find out. And so we're going to be talking about the power of God in healing. And before I get there, I want to ask you a question. Are you a medical missionary? Now, I just described what a medical missionary does. Are you one? Let me ask you this question. Is it possible to be a Christian and not be a medical missionary? Well, let me show you from the Bible. Go with me, if you would, to the book of Matthew. You're in Matthew. Well, you know what? Let's go to Luke chapter 9. We'll switch it up and let Dr. Luke explain. Luke chapter 9, verse 1. Luke chapter 9 and verse 1 and 2. The Bible says in Luke chapter 9, verse 1 and 2. The Bible says in the book of Luke chapter 9, verses 1 and 2, it says, when you get there, just say amen. Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils. And to do what else? And to do what? Cure diseases. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to do what else? Heal the sick. And so, did you notice that he just gave the same thing twice? Power and authority over all devils and cure diseases. And then it says he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. That's just saying the same thing in a different way. So if you and I are Christians, if we are the disciples of Christ, then our job is to preach and to heal. Preaching doesn't mean that you stand up in the desk all the time. Preaching just means that, you know, when you're eating that salad at the restaurant, or you're eating your little sandwich and different things, people, you're preaching. When you're dressing in the morning, you're preaching. Preaching is how we live. But if you are a missionary, a medical missionary, then you are going to operate by God's plan. It's the acronym GODSPLAN, which are the natural remedies, and they stand for this. And this is a little bit longer. I'm going to go a little faster. God's plan is just simply godly trust, open air, daily exercise, sunshine, plenty of rest, lots of water, always temperate, and nutrition. These are God's laws of health. But more than that, you know, they're different. They're also doctors that visit. And I know some of you have heard these things before, and there's a reason why I go slower in this part, is because medical ministry is not herbology. It is very important that you and I understand how charcoal works. That's important. You and I knowing how charcoal works, but knowing what it does and what else you can do, that if you don't have charcoal, you can use potato. Or you can use cabbage to do this same exact job. And so medical ministry is not just knowing a specific recipe of things, but you know the recipes are good. And so these are his 8 medical detectives, which are going to help us today to just solve the great distress problem that we have. And so let me move forward and get to our talk. All right. So we're going to be dealing with Dr. Trust in the Loving God today. Anybody know what this picture's of? Anybody know what year this picture was taken? It was taken in the year of the time of the end. 1989. And it's the Tiananmen Square massacre. Now, you know, in China, they don't know anything about this. The vast majority of Chinese never even heard of this because it's censored and it's blocked. But this picture was taken by a journalist that was had his camera down, kind of hidden, that was up in a hotel that was watching what was going on. And the people said, "We want liberty." And there was an uprising. And they brought in these tanks. And you see only four there. There was about a row of 30 tanks. And the day before, they took those tanks and they actually just rolled over a bunch of people. And I have pictures of when they went and they washed off the tanks of the body parts and the blood. But here you have a man, and at least see what he's doing right there? You see what he got in his hand? It looks like he just went to the grocery store. He wasn't intending on standing for freedom that day. But he saw an injustice and he went out there and he stood. That's just like David when he stood up against Goliath, or when Samson when he had to fight the lion. It was just crazy. And so this here, I want to talk to you today about the great distress. This is about your body and stress. What happens? There is a physiological thing, a series of events that happen when you start to stress. Do you know that when you're stressing about a test, it's the same as what this man's dealing with right here? When you're stressing about finances or you're stressing about relationships or any of these things, your body doesn't know the difference between this and a lion or a bear or a bill. Your body does the exact same thing. There is no difference. This man, does he look happy to you? No, no, no. He looks like he is worried. Anybody you ever get any of those wrinkles on your foreheads that come from, you know, when you're starting to worry? What about her? She looks like a happy young lady? No. So you've already read Luke 21, verses 25 and 26. Let's go there again. Luke 21, 25 and 26. The Bible says in Luke 21, 25 and 26, the Bible says, "And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth," what? "Distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring." I got this idea, actually. Well, this comes from the Bible, but Pastor Sankey helped me with this one time. I was watching him. Somebody tell me, what are the dates of Luke 21, 25? Anybody know the historical or biblical dates that are in here of the events? You know these are a series of events. "And there shall be signs in the," what? "In the sun and in the moon." What is the year? Don't give me the date. What's the year when there was a sign in the sun? 17 what? 1780. Right? What about the sun and the moon? Anybody? Don't look at your dad. It was the same day. The same day for the sun. That the sun went dark is the same day that the moon turned to blood. I believe it. Oops, sorry, messing up. 1780. All right. This is a quiz, because I know the pastor taught it. Amen. Now, what about the next one? Because you'll see that this is a progression. One happened in the day and the other happened in the evening. So the sun, the moon, and then the stars. What was the year for the stars? What year did the stars fall to earth? What'd you say? It's okay if you give 18 what? 1833, is that what I hear? You see, some people, you know, there's a lesson that I learned as a child. And I learned it when I was learning how to walk. I don't know if you learned this lesson. When you were learning how to walk, there's two things that are happening. You're learning how to walk, and you are the one that's learning how to walk. And first you learn how to stand, and you hold on to something, right? And when you learn how to stand, and you finally you get brave enough, and you see everybody else walking, so you start to think, I can do that, right? By beholding, you become changed. And so you do this, right? And then like maybe you get a little scared, and so you hold on to something, and you learn how to walk, and you hold on, right? But then one day you let go, and you start to walk, and then you fall. What do you do? Well, that's it all depends, right? The people around you, they pick you up and they're like, oh, they coddle you and they do like I do. You're okay, get on up. Mean daddy. Better. And so the same thing here, and I'm saying this for a purpose. It's okay to get the wrong answer now. You understand? Don't be afraid of giving an answer if you think it might be wrong, because mistakes are sometimes our best teachers. And this is a safe place to make a mistake. All right, so 1833, the stars fell. And then what's it say after that? And upon the earth, what? Distress of nations. And so the distress of nations, we know that historically, this actually began in the year 1838. There was a civil war that was happening in Islam. And see, these are all steps to the approaching coming of the Lord. They were looking that the Lord was going to come in about 1843, 1844 time period. And in 1838, the distress of nations was Islam. And let me show this to you from the Bible. Go with me to Genesis chapter 16. Because I want to give you a parallel. Genesis chapter 16. This same, we are living within this time frame. And upon the earth, distress of nations. Genesis chapter 16 and verse 11. Speaking of Ishmael, Genesis 16, verse 11. Speaking of Ishmael, the Bible says, and the angel of the Lord said unto her, behold, thou art with child and shalt bear a son, and shalt call his name what? Ishmael. And why? What does Ishmael's name mean? Because the Lord hath heard thy affliction. Stop for a second. I'm just going to give you something. This is especially for you ladies. This here is called epigenetics. All right? Epigenetics. Genetics just means your genome. It means the things that you get from your mom and dad that makes you who you are, your hair color, all that stuff. Epigenetics is multi-generational. And here's what this means. Ladies, when your grandmother was pregnant with your mother, so you have grandma, right? And she was pregnant with your mom. This is epigenetics, okay? This is the Bible. The Bible teaches this in the Ten Commandments. When your grandmother was pregnant with your mother, all of your mother's eggs were being formed while she was in the womb of your grandmother. You understand? So that means that you, ladies, were in your grandmother's womb with your mom. Do you understand that? Do you know what that means? That means that if your grandma was under a lot of stress, how many generations, if she was under a lot of stress when she was pregnant, how many generations is she going to affect? At least three. You understand? If she was having a struggle with whatever she was struggling with, whatever she was dealing with, guess who else was dealing with it? Mother and daughter. Now, you know that Paul uses this reasoning. He doesn't call it epigenetics, but he says that Levi paid tithe when he was in Abraham's loins. So that means that this works not only for men, but also for women, but for men in a slightly different way. Do you understand what I'm saying? And so what I'm saying to you is that whatever is happening to you is happening to more than just you. And so in Genesis 16, and the reason why I tell you this is because it says, why is Ishmael, look at verse 12. It says, and he will be a what? Now, why is he going to be wild? Do you know what made Ishmael wild? Because God said that he was going to hear his affliction. Why was Ishmael afflicted? What was his affliction? Well, Sarai, who became Sarah, tried to cause Hagar to have an abortion by beating on her. And she was beating on her in such a way that the baby would be lost. And in order for the baby to overcome, God strengthened Ishmael and allowed that thing. If you get hit, do you get mad? No, don't raise your hand. Right? Any of us have brothers and sisters that sometimes, I used to be a rock'em sock'em brother. I was a mean big brother. I'm the oldest of seven children, and the first three of us, oh man, I used to rule with an iron fist. My mom and dad leave, and I'm like, listen, I'm in charge. You don't do what I say, mom can't save you. She ain't here. And then, but the Lord fixed that one for me because when I was 14, my family had a vote on whether or not I could stay in the house. And it was 2-2. My mom and dad voted no, and my brother and sister voted yes. No, the two I used to beat up. And you know, I never hit them after that because they loved me even though I had mistreated them. Have mercy. And so here, what happened was is that Ishmael, who? Ishmael was afflicted by an unconverted woman. The church. And she afflicted him while in the womb, so God allowed the stress that would have destroyed him to be the stress to make him stronger. And that's why he ended up being a wild man. At least that's the part of the medical reasoning, physiological reasoning. But it says, not only is he going to be a wild man, verse 12, it says, and his hand will be against every man, and every man's hand against him, and he shall dwell in the presence of who? All his brethren. So now watch this. So Ishmael, who is he mad at? He's really mad at the woman that was trying to beat him, but he couldn't help because he was in the womb. He couldn't see who it was. He was just mad. If you hurt me, then I'm going to hurt you. That's how Ishmael came out. You understand? So when Ishmael's children are born, they're born with the same disposition that he got while he was in the mother's womb. And so the Bible says, upon the earth, distress of nations. Why does it say this? It says, his hand will be against every man. So Ishmael, first he fights with his own self or within his own household, but out of the abundance of the mouth, the heart speaketh. He then starts to fight with everybody else. Now listen, you understand this principle. If you fight your brother and sister, will you fight people at church? If you fight your husband and wife, will you fight the guy at work? You understand the principle? If you love at home, is it more likely that you'll love outside of home? You see the principle. All right. So go back to Luke chapter 21. So distress of nations. This is the civil war that was happening from 1838 to 1840. And then after this, in Luke 21, verse 25, it says, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. Then it says in verse 26, men's hearts failing them for, what do they fear? What are they afraid of? What are they afraid of? Well, one thing they're afraid of is Ishmael and his children. The other thing they're afraid of is, it's not called climate change in the Bible. It says sun, moon, and the sea and the waves roaring. It says the thing they're afraid of, it says specifically they're afraid for the future. Huh? And so this is the thing that I want to deal with today. The Bible says in the book of Romans, chapter 8, and verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? It doesn't say what shall separate you from the love of Christ. It says who? And who is it that can separate you from the love of Christ? Only your decision. But then it goes on. You can read the rest of that yourself. It says, but I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor what? Powers, nor things present or things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of Christ, from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so what is the thing that God is trying to give us? It's love. Let me show you this little video here about stress.
It was a major breakthrough. It was a major breakthrough. Stress didn't cause ulcers. Case closed. But a few years later, the research took a new twist. Scientists discovered that this ulcer-causing bacteria wasn't unique. In fact, as much as two-thirds of the world's population has it. So why do only a fraction of these people develop ulcers? Research revealed that when stressed, the body begins shutting down all non-essential systems, including the immune system. And it became clear that if you shut down the immune system, stomach bacteria can run amok.
Because what the stress does is wipe out the ability of your body to begin to repair your stomach walls when they start rotting away from this bacteria.
So stress can cause ulcers by disrupting our body's ability to heal itself. If stress can undermine the immune system, what other havoc can it wreak? One answer comes from a colony of captive macaque monkeys near Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
People think of stress as something that keeps them up at night or something that makes them yell at their kids. But when you ask me, what is stress? I say, look at it. It's this huge plaque in this artery. That's what stress is.
For two decades, Dr. Carol Shively has been studying the arteries of macaques. Like baboons and British civil servants, these primates organize themselves into distinctly hierarchical groups and subject one another to social stress. Stress hormones can trigger an intense negative cardiovascular response, a pounding heart, and increased blood pressure. So if stress follows rank, would the cardiovascular system of a high-ranking macaque, call him a primate CEO, be different from his subordinate? When Shively looked at the arteries of a dominant monkey, one with little history of stress, its arteries were clean. But a subordinate monkey's arteries told a grim tale.
A subordinate artery has lots more atherosclerosis built up inside it than a dominant artery is.
Stress and the resulting flood of hormones had increased blood pressure, damaging artery walls, making them repositories for plaque.
So now when you feel threatened, your arteries don't expand and your heart muscle doesn't get more blood, and that can lead to a heart attack. This is not an abstract concept. It's not something that maybe someday you should do something about. You need to attend to it today because it's affecting the way your body functions. And stress today will affect your health tomorrow and for years to come.
Social and psychological stress, whether macaque, human, or baboon, can clog our arteries, restrict blood flow, jeopardize the health of our heart. And that's just the beginning of stress's deadly curse. Robert's early research demonstrated that stress can work on us in an even more frightening way.
Well, back when I was starting in this business, what I wound up focusing on was what seemed an utterly implausible idea at the time, which was chronic stress and chronic exposure to glucocorticoids could do something as unsubtle and grotesque as kill some of your brain cells.
As a PhD candidate at Rockefeller University in the early 80s, Sapolsky collaborated with his mentor, Dr. Bruce McEwen, to follow the path of stress into the brain. They subjected lab rats to chronic stress and then examined their brain cells. The team made an astonishing find. While the cells of normal rat brains have extensive branches, stressed rats' brain cells were dramatically smaller,
And what was most interesting in many ways was the part of the brain where this was happening, hippocampus. You take intro neurobiology any time for the last 5,000 years, and what you learn is hippocampus is learning and memory.
Stress in these rats shrank the part of their brain responsible for memory.
Stress affects memory in two ways. Chronic stress can actually change brain circuits so that we lose the capacity to remember things as we need to. Very severe acute stress can have another effect, which is often we refer to as stress makes you stupid, which is making it impossible for you in over short periods of time to remember things you know perfectly well.
We all know that phenomenon. We all know that one from back when we stressed ourselves by not getting any sleep at all, and the next morning at 9 o'clock, we couldn't remember a single thing for that final exam. You take a human and stress them big time, long time, and you're going to have a hippocampus that pays the price as well.
In addition to undermining our health, stress can make us feel plain miserable. Carol Shively set out to find out why. She began not with misery, but with pleasure. Shively suspected that there was a link between stress, pleasure, and where we stand in the social hierarchy. Just like stress, pleasure is linked to the chemistry of the brain. When a neurotransmitter called dopamine is released in the brain, it binds to receptors signaling pleasure. Shively used a PET scanner to examine the brain of a non-stressed primate, our primate CEO.
What we see is that the brains of dominant monkeys light up bright with lots of dopamine binding in this area that's so important to reward and feeling pleasure about life.
Shively then looked at the subordinate's brain.
What we discovered is that the brains of the subordinate monkeys are very, very dull, because there's much less receptor binding going on in this area. Why is that? What is it about this area of the brain? When you have less dopamine, everything around you that you would normally take pleasure in is less pleasurable. So the sun doesn't shine so bright, the grass is not so green, food doesn't taste as good. It's because of the way your brain is functioning that you're doing that, and your brain's functioning that way because you're low on the social status hierarchy.
One feature of low rank is being low ranking, the reality. An even stronger feature by the time you get to humans is not just being low ranking or poor, it's feeling low ranking or poor. And one of the best ways for society to make you feel like one of the have-nots is to rub your nose over and over and over again with what you don't have.
Richmond, California, a town where society's extremes can be spotted right from your car. This is cardiologist Jeffrey Ritterman's regular commute.
You can learn a lot about the stress and health outcome just from the neighborhoods you visit. In this neighborhood, the life expectancy is quite good, and most of the people are pretty healthy. And as we reach the top of the hill, it gets to be a little bit less privileged. And as we make this transition, the social status begins to drop, and correspondingly, in those areas, the health outcome is much worse. And these people are not going to have the same life expectancy as the people in the middle class area we started in. People are on guard. People are vigilant. They're living a more stressful life. This is a community that produces high stress hormones in people, and over time, it takes its toll.
One of Dr. Ritterman's patients is 65-year-old Emmanuel Johnson. His career? Guidance counselor in one of America's most dangerous neighborhoods.
Well, last year, I think we had 47 homicides. You know, in the last 4 days, we had 11 shootings, 3 deaths. And I just know 9 times out of 10, it's going to be a relative or someone that the kids know.
For Emmanuel Johnson, there is a price for chronic exposure to this stress.
5 years ago, I had a heart attack. I'm a diabetic, too. I have to work on it constantly. I've been in this business 20 years, so it's stressful just working the job. So over the years, the the cholesterol, the blood pressure, the sugar came on later, but the stress was always there long before they came on.
Emmanuel Johnson's body may be telling yet another story of stress. The Whitehall study in England found an incredible link between stress, your position in the social hierarchy, and how you put on weight.
What we just saw in this video that was about 9 minutes long. One of the things that he says in this video here, and I'll turn it over here this way so you can see it. It says one of the first things that happens when you and I are under stress, and this is specifically chronic stress. And stress, I want you to think of stress like this, is, you know, when you see, how many of you have ever been chased by a dog before? When I was about 5 years old, I was in foster care, and I was walking home from kindergarten, and so the foster mom, she didn't come and get me. She told me to walk home, and however far it was, I don't remember, I decided to go look for my mom. And so I'm walking around the city that I lived in, this big city. I'm walking around going, Mama! Mama! Just walking up and down the street. And when I get to one neighborhood, I see this dog just laying in the front yard. And the dog looked up and he saw me. I saw the dog and he saw me, and we both knew instinctively it's on. And so the dog starts chasing me, I start running. I'm not sure which one happened first. And so we're running, and I'm running in circles. You never run in a straight line when you're running from an animal. Amen. You run in different lanes, and I didn't know that, I just did that. And I ran, and then I saw a door like this, but it had a screen on it. And I ran to that door, and I went inside that house, and I shut the door. I didn't even know whose house it was. And it happened to be, it was a very nice lady, and she called the police, and the police came and got me. But I was running from the dog. The stress levels that you have when you're going to run from a dog or a bear or a lion or a bully is the same thing. Immediately, your immune system drops. There is no need for you to be fighting a cold because you're now dealing with life or death issues. You understand? So the body shuts down your immune system when you're under stress. If you're under chronic stress that lasts for years, this is how you develop cancer. This is how you develop diabetes. This is how you develop many other chronic diseases. It's because of what? Stress. And so the immune system, I didn't say it shuts down. Okay? The brain begins to shrink. Well, actually, let's deal with this one. Because what happens when you're under stress, one of the things that the body does is it starts to give you extra fuel. Your body has a couple of different kinds of fuel that it can use. It uses glucose, which is just sugar. It's the form of sugar that your body uses for fuel. But in order to give you there's another kind of fuel that you can use that's actually twice as powerful, but it does come with side effects. It's called fat. So when your brain tells the body that it's under stress, it starts to release fat into your arterial system so that your muscles can, the vessels open up really wide, and so that your muscles can, you can run or you can fight, and in your brain so that you can think. And so, but if you don't use it, if you don't actually use that extra energy, then it goes in, and that's how you end up building plaque into your system. Do you understand? The fat gets, it goes into your arterial system and it stays there. Your blood pressure goes up when you're under stress, whether real or imagined. And I'm going to show this to you in a moment. But what's happening, not only do your arteries start to harden, your blood pressure, if you get plaque in there, your blood pressure goes up, but now your brain is affected. Your brain actually starts to shrink. You start to lose the capacity to actually think. That's why stress makes you stupid. Stress makes you do things. You know, my mom was extremely afraid of birds. Extremely afraid. My great-grandmother, my grandpa's wife used to punish her when she was a little child by putting her in the chicken house and shutting the door, leaving her in there when she was 4 years old. And so the roosters were bigger than her, and they would attack her, and so she grew up afraid of birds. So any bird, a little bird, the only bird she trusted was a chicken with no head in the sink or in a pan, right? And so any bird, and so a bird, she could be driving down the freeway and a bird fly toward the car and she will try to jump out the car. Stress makes you stupid. You understand what I'm saying? So unnatural fears, and so your brain begins to shrink. You actually lose the capacity to remember under stress. Some of you have been to college. Some of you remember at school. You stress out about something, and all of a sudden you can't remember. This is why what happens to a lot of young ladies at about the age of 12. 12, and they start thinking about how pretty they are or not, whichever one it is. And they start concerned about all the social things, and then all of a sudden, where they used to get good grades, now their grades start to dip. It's all because of stress. And so your capacity, your ability to learn actually lessens. Your dopamine binding, that's the receptors for pleasure, are lessened under stress. And so certain things happen. It kills brain cells. It changes the brain circuits. Now watch this. You and I are either operating out of two principles. We're either operating out of the principle of love, or we're operating out of the principle of fear. Do you know that? The Bible says perfect love does something. It casts out all what? Fear, because fear is irrational. Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with how much? All thine heart, and lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall do what? Direct thy paths. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Why? What's going to happen when you fear God? Not when you fearing God is not talking about being afraid of him, but it's talking about a reverence, a godly fear, which is different than a fearful fear. It says, fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be what? Anybody there in verse 8? It shall be health to thy navel and what else? Marrow to your bones. Now watch. Why is it health to your navel? Because under stress, the body is dumping fat into the system, and you start to gain, it changes your body's shape. Stress will make you have what's called an apple body shape. That means all the weight is in your midsection, primarily. You understand? This is where, when you're stressed, and what happens is the fat that is there actually produces hormones that make it hard for you to lose weight and not be stressed. It's a thing that keeps feeding on itself. You understand what I'm saying? A self-perpetuating thing. And so one of the things I'm trying to show you is this is what stress is doing to you. And this is not even all of it. And I'm not trying to stress you out. I'm going to give you some hope in the end, I hope. All right? So question, what's a fold? Oh, I guess I'm going to have to go back. Go with me in your Bibles. Well, you know what? Actually, this is here. What's a fold? I'm going to tell you this for a reason. Go with me to John chapter 10, verse 16. John chapter 10 and verse 16. Anybody in here know what a fold is? A biblical fold? Now, many of us know what a fold is, right? You take a piece of paper. There you go. You take a piece of paper and you fold it, right? And this is how anybody here used to make paper airplanes? It's all about the fold, right? It's all about the fold. And so a fold is actually bringing two things together. Is what a fold is. But it's also a doubling in a sense. But here it says this in verse 16, and other sheep I have, which are not of this what? This fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be what? One fold and one shepherd. So now watch this. The fold means that he's going to bring these two things together, right? All right, let's look at another one, Isaiah 13 and verse 20. Isaiah 13 and verse 20, just letting the Bible speak for itself, letting the Bible describe itself. Isaiah 13 and verse 20, the Bible says, the scriptures say in Isaiah 13 and verse 20, speaking about Babylon, it says, verse 20, it shall never be inhabited, neither shall it be dwelt in from generation to generation, neither shall the Arabian pitch tent there, neither shall the shepherds make their what? Their fold there. So a fold is not only a place you bring together, that things are brought together, but a fold is some place that where there is a joining or a gathering, as it were. You understand? All right, let's look at one more. Micah. Micah chapter 2 and verse 12. If you find Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Psalms, Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, and then Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum. And so right before Micah chapter 2 and verse 12. Micah chapter 2 and verse 12. Micah chapter 2 and verse 12. The Bible says in Micah 2:12, I will surely do what? Assemble, O Jacob, all of thee. I will surely gather the remnant of Israel. I will put them together as a sheep of Bozrah, as the flock in the midst of their fold. They shall make great noise by reason of the multitude of men. So this flock, this fold, is our men. All right, Matthew 13 and verse 8. Just two more. Matthew 13 and verse 8. This is just a few of the verses that talk about a fold. Matthew 13 and verse 8. Matthew 13 and verse 8. In that great parable of the sower that went forth to sow, Matthew 13 verse 8, it says, but other fell into what? Good ground and brought forth fruit, some an hundredfold, some 60-fold, and some what? 30-fold. So a fold here is now attached to a number. You see that? So now this number is not just a bringing together, but there's a number associated with fold. And let's look at one more, our last one on this point. That's Luke 8, verse 8. Thank you. Luke 8, verse 8. Luke 8, verse 8. The Bible says in Luke 8, verse 8, and other fell on good ground and sprang up and bare fruit and hundredfold. And when he had said these things, he cried, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Now I'm going to ask you a question. Again, the question is, what's a fold? I just misplaced that statement. And so is there a difference between 100 times and 100-fold? A fold is different than times. And I'm going to show this to you. This is from a website I saw online, and it was asking this question. This gentleman's from 2008, Robert Bright. I'm just giving him the props for it because I didn't come up with it myself. And so I was doing an understanding on agriculture. That's how I came to this, okay? And so let's do a paper experiment. Some of you might have a piece of paper. Take a piece of paper and you fold it in half. Now, how many do you have? Two, right? Right? Okay. So now fold it again. How many do you have? Okay. So now you have four, right? Now do you fold it again? How many do you have? How many you got? Eight. All right? And so if you fold it the third time, you're going to end up with eight. Now, what if you folded it 30 times? What number do you think you're going to get? All right? That's the number you're going to get. You're going to get, if you were able, because you can't fold paper that many times. If you're going to get it, you're going to get 1,073,701,824. That's 30-fold. But the Lord didn't say he wants you to have 30-fold. That's actually the low bottom rung of the number. Right? He says he wants you to have, what about 60-fold? Look at this one here. 60-fold gives you that number. Now, I didn't even know that these numbers existed until I did this. And this number here is 1 quintillion, 151 quadrillion, 973 trillion, 21 billion, 73,889,000, thank you, 216, which is slightly more than double 30-fold. Now, that's what God wants to give you if you have that good soil and that good seed. That's not even 100-fold. Let me show you what 100-fold is. That's 1 non-nillion, 201 octillion, 64 septillion, 595 sextillion, 207 quintillion, 167 quadrillion, 685 trillion, 882 billion, 431 million, 343,616. That's 100-fold. See, the possibilities that God wants to do for you through love is represented by that number right there. Now, the Bible says, or the Bible, you know his name, he's called the Wonderful Numberer, right? Palmoni, the Wonderful Numberer. This is my point, because I'm going to show you a video that's going to talk about 20,000-fold and what happens to your stomach or your gut, all right?
Well, one of the first challenges that I've noticed
Living in America and working with mostly Americans, is that we tend to eat under a state of stress and a state of anxiety. And when I say stress and anxiety, I'm also talking about the physiologic stress response. And when we are eating under the physiologic stress response, we could be eating the healthiest food in the universe, but we won't necessarily be fully digesting and assimilating and calorie burning that food. And here's, you know, more specifically what I mean. The physiologic stress response, that's an ancient evolutionary adaptation, such that eons ago, when you and I were getting chased by the lion, we developed this brilliant mechanism such that heart rate goes up, blood pressure goes up, blood is shunted away from your midsection, the blood goes to arms, legs, and head for quick fighting or fleeing, and blood's rushing to your head for quick thinking. And under those circumstances, digestion completely shuts down in a full-blown stress response, because when the lion's chasing you and you're running or fighting for your life, you don't need to be digesting your breakfast cereal. All your metabolic energy needs to go into survival. So the point is, classic textbook definition of stress is any real or imagined threat and the body's response to it. So a real or imagined threat. So you don't have to be chased by a lion right now in order for the body to go into a stress response. You could be sitting at home thinking, you know, gee, it's too cold. I'm not good enough. I'm not making enough money. I'm upset with my wife. I'm upset with work. That will throw the body into some degree of stress response.
Or the economy is failing.
Yeah, just a mild stressor right there.
Sure.
So some of the metabolic parameters that are going on in the body under a stress response, first of all, nutrient absorption measurably decreases. You have decreased oxygenation to the gut. You have as much as 4 times less blood flow to the digestive system. Enzymatic output in the gut can decrease by as much as 20,000-fold. It's actually mind-blowing. You'll see a lot of nutrient excretion during stress, particularly water-soluble minerals, water-soluble vitamins, particularly macro minerals, micro minerals. You'll also see blood cholesterol shoot up. You'll see serum triglycerides shoot up. You'll see gut flora populations go down. You'll see increased sensitivity to food. You will see gastroesophageal reflux, which basically means heartburn. And probably most importantly, under the stress response, two hormones particularly increase, and that'll be cortisol and insulin, which tend to track each other. So when cortisol is constantly increased under continued low-level stress response, what we tend to see is inability to lose weight. We see inability to lose body fat. We see inability to build muscle. And with excess cortisol, a lot of people have heard this now, we particularly see weight gain around the midsection. So without stressing you out too much by talking about eating under stress, the bottom line is that under stress, we are putting the body in the opposite condition of where we would like it to be in order to digest and assimilate and calorie burn. You introduce a stressor to someone and then you measure calcium excretion in the urine, it can increase within an hour as much as 60 to 75 milligrams. That's a lot if you start to calculate that over the course of a day. If you start to look at other factors that would cause a person to excrete calcium, which could be alcohol, it could be caffeine, it could be cigarette smoke, it could be excess sugar, it could be excess protein, particularly meat, could be excess, poor quality carbohydrate. So, again, under stress, you'll see as much as four times less blood flow to the gut. That means less metabolism. You're going to see enzymatic output decreasing by 20,000-fold. It's stunning.
This one added a few things into our list here. It says, not only does your immune system stop, and I'll turn around over here. I can just hear my sister in the back saying, turn the wrong way. So not only does your immune system stop, your brain shrinks, your memory goes down, your learning goes down, your dopamine binding, it's greatly lessened, digestion stops, your nutrient absorption because you're under stress. Now, this is why I always tell, especially, how ladies, sometimes you just want to talk to the people in your lives and you come together at the meal and you want to talk about things. Well, the last thing you need to talk to them about, especially your husband, at mealtime is your relationship. Don't talk about your relationship at mealtime because it's a stressor. Don't talk about anything that's unpleasant at mealtime. And so now I was, as an EMT, we used to drive. You drive an ambulance and you would go see accidents and you would go do different things like this. And we were, and you find body parts and stuff like that. And I knew men as an EMT that could eat a sandwich and just be looking at that body or looking at those parts going, man, that's messed up. That's a problem. Actually, we don't want to be like that. And so what happens is you can't absorb nutrients under stress. It's not possible. So it doesn't matter how healthy the food is. If you're under stress, it's not going to be absorbed. Your enzymatic production decreases by 20,000-fold. So the enzymes are the helpers that help you to absorb nutrition. And so your vitamin production goes down. Your calcium levels go down. And especially for ladies, this is one reason why women end up getting osteoporosis, is stress. On top of eating things that cause you to lose calcium, your B vitamin intake goes down. It says your heart rate goes up, your gut flora. That means the bacteria. So a lot of people under stress end up getting something called H. pylori or getting other different diseases that afflict their gut. And it's primarily because it's a stress-related disease. Heartburn goes up, your cortisol and insulin levels go up, and that's not even including if you overeat when you're stressed. You understand? That's just what happens. And so you can't lose weight, and you have four times less blood going to your abdominal area. Those are the physiological things that are happening to you. So this is why stress is a killer. All right? And so What are the remedies for it? Because we're just a little over an hour, and I'm going to give you the remedies for dealing with stress. And so this is God's plan. It's godly trust, open air, daily exercise, sunshine, plenty of rest, lots of water, always temperate, and nutrition. These will help you to know how to deal with stress. It doesn't matter how old you are or what's going on in your life. First one we're going to deal with is godly trust. The Bible says in Proverbs 23, verse 7, "For as he thinketh in his heart," what does that say? So what you and I think about, that's what we are. So you and I get to determine love or fear. It's not the problem, it's how you look at the problem. You understand? You can focus on the negative side, or you can look at it and say, all things are possible. Praise God, I got a miracle-working God. And I wrote down some stressors here, because I don't know about your family, but sometimes money as a self-supporting missionary can be a challenge. Huh? It don't matter. Sometimes some of you got good jobs and money's a challenge. Because I have friends that, you know, they make $500,000 a year, and they spend $600,000 a year. You understand? And so whether or not work is a challenge. Why is work a challenge? Because of the relationships and the money aspect that are connected to that. Family. Anybody here stress over family? Single people stress over not having a family. Married people, a great number of them, are stressing because they wish they were single. Terrorism. And what I mean by terrorism is I don't mean that ISIS. I mean somebody is coming after you, bothering you. I used to be a terrorist to my little brother and my little sister. And so crime, pain, physical, mental, or otherwise, and health problems, all of these can be stressors. Now, stress can have a wonderful effect upon you because you and I have strong bones because of stress. When you learn how to walk and gravity and all these different things and running, those things actually strengthen your bones because it causes your body to put more calcium layers upon the bones. Okay? The Bible says this in Philippians 1:7. Even as it is meet for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, ye are partakers of my grace. What's he saying? As I'm thinking in my heart, that's how it is in my life. That's the principle. Okay? So it starts with the thoughts. And this is taken from Great Controversy, Desire of Ages, page 324. Can you see that? Desire of Ages 324 says, when the soul does what? Surrender. So now here is the issue. How do you deal with stress? Number one, you have to surrender. You and I cannot change what happened to us in the womb, what happened to us when we were little children. We can't change naturally our responses to things. Each one of us, our mothers, had a different experience when you can look at the different children in the family and say, what was mom dealing with while she was pregnant? If mom had an appetite issue when she was pregnant, you can see that in the child. If mom was stressed out, you can see that in the child. If mom was happy and at peace, like when with Jesus and John the Baptist, their mothers were full of the Holy Ghost. But we can be born again, and that's what it means when the soul surrenders itself to Christ. A new power takes possession of the new heart. A change is wrought which man can what? Can you say never with me? Say, I cannot change myself. Very good. You just declare that you are not a pagan. Because that's what pagans believe. They just work on it, work on it, work on it, and then one day they'll be God. I can keep working all day long, but I'm not changing how hard my head is. I need to surrender that hard head. And when the soul surrenders itself to Christ, a new power takes possession of the new heart. A change is wrought which man can never accomplish for himself. It is a supernatural work, bringing a supernatural element into human nature. The soul that is yielded to Christ becomes his own fortress, which he holds in a revolted world. And he intends that no authority shall be known in it but his own. A soul thus kept in possession by the heavenly agencies is, what's that word right there? impregnable to the assaults of Satan. Do you believe the word of God? But unless we do yield ourselves to the control of Christ, we shall be what? Dominated by the wicked one. So you don't actually have to choose. This is that term that he forces himself on you. He says we must inevitably be under the control of the one or the other of the two great powers that are contending for the supremacy of the world. It is not necessary for us to deliberately choose the service of the kingdom of darkness in order to come under his dominion, its dominion. We have only to do, what's that word right there? Neglect to ally ourselves with the kingdom of light. If we do not cooperate with the heavenly agencies, Satan will take possession of the heart and will make it what? His abiding place. And that's a frightening thought. The, what's that four-letter word? The only defense against evil is the indwelling of Christ in the heart. Through faith in his righteousness, that means recognizing that it doesn't matter how hard I work, I can never do it. I can never do it. It's about me submitting and recognizing that he's going to do what he promised. And it says, unless we become vitally connected with God, we can never resist the unhallowed effects of self-love, self-indulgence, and temptation to sin. We may leave off many bad habits for the time, we may part company with Satan, but without a vital connection with God, through surrender of ourselves to him, what's that? I did it yesterday. Well, we need to do it again. Moment by moment, we shall be overcome. Without a personal acquaintance with Christ, we shall and a continual communion, we are at the mercy of the enemy and shall do his bidding in the end. And that's a frightening thought. Two choices, love or fear. Ephesians 5:17. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Let me ask you a question. How can you and I become filled with the Spirit? Well, the Bible says in the very next verse, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. So you know what God designed to actually have you to be filled with the Spirit? Music, brothers and sisters. The power of music. It can change your mind. You know what happens when you go in the grocery store and you go in there and all of a sudden they're playing that song, and that song reminds you of exactly where you were when you heard that song, and whatever thing, all these things happen to you. The same way God wants to take that response and use it for good, for love. You're just, something happens and you say, a merry heart, do as good like a man. And somebody might look at you like, oh, why are you? You're singing, but the Bible says here, singing and making melody in your heart to who? Does it say you have to sing good? It don't say anything about singing well. Amen. It just says sing. It says giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So now watch, singing and praying go together, and I'm going to show you that in a moment. Submitting yourselves to one another in the fear of God. So in order to deal with stress, you and I have to submit. But he ties two things together. And this is something that is very important if you and I are going to overcome our stress. Because we normally respond. Two things that go together are music and prayer. In the Bible, music and prayer are associated together. It says that here in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 14, verse 15. What is it then? I will pray with the what? With the Spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also. I will do what? I will sing with the Spirit, and I will do what else? I will sing with the understanding also. So prayer is, singing is just like praying. You understand? That's why the Lord wants you to sing. Because in the verse before, it says that's how you get filled with the Holy Ghost. Oops, excuse me. So open air. One of the things that you need to do if you're under a lot of stress is you need to take deep breaths. It helps you to relax. Deep breaths. Deep breathing exercises. We used to play this game. I'm not going to tell you what it was. When I was a kid, we used to breathe heavily and then hold our breath and pass out. That was crazy. Don't do that. Right? We used to think it was funny. Fall over, crack your head, end up with stitches. I mean, how many times? But deep breathing exercises where you lean over, put your hands down, and you breathe as deeply as you can. Okay? And you do it 10 times. It's called an oxygen cocktail. Deep breathing, it's very good for your brains, but it also relaxes your nerves. Deep breathing. Another one is fresh air in your bedchamber. Wherever you're sleeping, if at all possible, you want fresh air to be in the bedroom. This will help you to deal with stress. Now, if opening the window stresses you out, you know, you got to open a window in someplace upstairs, maybe, you know, something else. Do something. Try to get some fresh air in your house. All right? Daily exercise and sunshine. Well, here's this. Walking is especially important for stress. Exercise is the best walking. The best exercise is walking, especially after meals. It will help with the apple issue. The apple body shape, getting rid of that stuff because it's going to move your intestines, your large and your small intestines. It's going to help your body to process the meal that you have eaten. And so walk from up to 1 mile to 5 miles daily. Now, this is separate. Don't walk 5 miles after you eat. That was not good. But plan on walking at least 1 mile a day. And when you walk, don't walk like this. I mean, walk. Put some pep in the step. You know what I'm saying? Don't be a slow walker. All right. Now, lots of water. How does stress and water deal with one another? You need to drink at least half your body's weight in ounces every day. Why? Because your immune system needs water, your brain needs water, your memory needs water, to learn you need water, your digestion needs water. Don't drink with your meals, but in order to process your meals, you need water. It says, for all of these other things, you need water. And you need your arteries need water. Keep your blood pressure down, you need water. All of these things are so important. Water is extremely important. Drink half your body's weight in ounces. So if you weigh 100 pounds, drink 50 ounces of water, okay, per day. Take a bath at least 2 times a week. And if you're under heavy stress, you can take one every day. There is no contraindication to taking a bath. Yes, sir. Okay, yes. Okay, taking a bath doesn't mean shower, okay? Taking a bath, now you can, because in the old days, for 5,000 years, people would sponge off, you know, and you go and dip in the river or something like that, or in a tub for at least 2 times a week. That is for your skin. But showering, you can shower every day, but showering is not bathing. Bathing means sitting down and relaxing. Now, some of us stress out when we think we're going to have to waste that much time, they think, in the tub. But you need to remember that it is relaxing to the nerves when you sit in the tub of nice warm water. And you can put some of this in it, some of this Epsom salt, which is very good for the skin, you know, has magnesium sulfate in it, and it's extremely good for the muscles, all right? Always temperate and nutrition. They go together. And here is Job 23:12. Neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my what? Now listen. When many times when we stress, we want to eat. And if you are like me and others who want to eat when you're stressed, I'm suggesting go to the Word of God first. I'm starting to stress out, Lord, and you start to read. Connect your mind with Christ so that when you do go to eat your food, you can actually use what you're going to get by digesting it, because you're not going to digest anything while you're under stress. Are there any questions? None? Are you sure? All right. If you have a question, you can write it down on a piece of paper. the one that you maybe you folded up and put it down, and anything that you want to know especially over the next couple of days, I'll be happy to answer them for you. If you want to talk privately, that's fine as well. Yes, sir. Okay. A is always temperate, and N is nutrition. His question was, is what is A and what does N stand for? A is for always temperate, and N is for nutrition. God would have you and I to be temperate in all things. Amen? Yes, sir.
Is running bad for you? Or?
No, running is great. But what happens is that a lot of people that run end up hurting their joints. And that's the problem with running, is you end up generally having joint damage, which can end up you having different kinds of arthritis and things like that. And so that's a problem with running. Running is good. I actually suggest people do if they can, but if you, let's say somebody's overweight and they've gained a lot of weight, they have a lot of weight and they want to start losing weight. Before I ever suggest that they start walking, I tell them to go for short walks after they eat, but I suggest they start drinking water a week before they start exercising, because it'll help to start lubricating their joints and getting their body prepared for the loss of fat and in a situation to where they can actually deal with the loss of weight, because it's going to be very good for your joints. Yes, ma'am, wait for the microphone.
Can you drink too much water?
Yes, you can drink too much water, but it's hard. It's not about how much water you drink, it's the amount of time that you drink it in. So if you weigh 250 pounds and you need to drink then about a gallon of water every day, okay? A gallon's 128 ounces. And so you try to drink that gallon all in the morning, then you're gonna flush out your electrolytes. It's not gonna be good for you. You need to drink so that you can absorb. The spirit of prophecy says you can drink a quart of water at a time. Matter of fact, she says that before you eat, you can drink hot, which she doesn't mean scalding hot. She just means warm water, up to a quart of it right before you eat. She says it will never do you harm, only good. Okay? We're going to be talking a lot about hydrotherapy because it's one of the primary things that Christ mentions about healing at the end of the world. Any other questions?
Yes, earlier you said that if one wants to cleanse his or her colon, psyllium husk is good for that process. Now, what if one is at the stage of colon cancer? Would the psyllium husk be something that would...
Well, what happens is if you have colon cancer, the issue with that is do you have a blockage? Because if you have, we were working, when Elder Wilson was here a couple years ago, we went down into Los Angeles to help a lady that had a blockage, and we were trying to get a tube up so that we can get some water up in there so that it can actually get past, because she had a blockage. And so if you have a blockage and there's just if it's not completely blocked, if it's completely blocked, they're going to have surgery, okay? But if you can actually have some things, some people don't have a blockage. Some people have what's called a stricture where their colon is actually atrophied, is shrunk, and it's hardened. And so it's hard for them to pass anything through there. And so, but if you can get something through, psyllium should work. Sometimes you can give somebody, different things can help you to go to do a bowel movement. Sometimes I'll tell people, drink a gallon of warm apple juice. Take a half gallon of apple juice, warm it up, and drink it. And you will go, it'll do the same thing as if you took psyllium. And so you can do a seawater flush. It does something similar. You can do vitamin C. You take a lot of vitamin C, don't leave the house. That's the truth. I see some heads bowing, I'm telling you. You know. And so are there any other questions? If there are no questions, why don't we go ahead and bow for prayer and ask the Lord to be with us, to help us, because the Bible says, this is the Lord who helped us in all our distresses. Let's bow for prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you again that You do not remove all of the cause for stress, but that you said that you would walk with us through the fire. You said that you would never leave us nor forsake us. And you asked the question through Brother Paul, who shall separate us from the love of God? And then you list all of these different things that seem like they can separate us, but it doesn't stop you from loving us. It just stops us from seeing your love. So, Lord, I pray for your people. Heart disease is in the Bible as being the number one killer at the end of the world. And so, Lord, we need help. Help us to overcome our fear and our stress, that we, Father, might live by faith, which works by love. So be with us now, and thank you again for these things. In Jesus' name.